So welcome. My name is Alexey Kimel. I'm working here in the Netherlands in Nijmegen at the Institute for Molecules and Materials, and my department is working on the studies of ultrafast phenomena. I don't know if you saw the title of my lectures or masterclass. I have never been asked to submit the title, so they only asked me to send abstract to the talk, so I did it. So I decided to call the lecture, so masterclass today, ultrafast phenomena. So I don't know, what are there any specific goals that you have while attending the masterclass? What do you want from me, actually? What do you want to learn?
Some
of my knowledge. Okay, so then any specific goals? So not all of you are working with lasers, right? So this, what is the who is working with condensed matter physics? So that's okay, for roughly 50% laser physics, so lasers. Okay. Atomic physics, molecules. So that's is anybody working on the field I haven't mentioned? So we basically covered everything related. So then I will try to stay within this the frames of these topics, and I will start with the motivation. So then, since all of us are working and with lasers and with condensed matter physics, so then one of the goals of my lecture, this would be easy goal to achieve, to convince you that condensed matter physics is the most hottest topic in today's magnetism. Today's physics, sorry. So that's then I also, if I think about physics in total, so that now if I have to tell this story to people at school, for instance, or like to people who is not studying physics, and I have to draw a map of physics today. What are the most interesting things that happening in physics? So of course we know that there is a classical physics. Something that has been studied very well. We understand this area very well. So it starts with classical mechanics. Then also there's a theory of electromagnetic waves. Then what happened in the beginning of 20th century, that people realized that if they go to the very small scale, physics becomes different, and then get this quantum physics. And what we have in, right now is that we have classical physics where our intuition is very strong, because we can train our intuition every day. And we have quantum physics, which we learn in the right way only in the university. And then what you learn is, what you can understand intuitively is probably a model of hydrogen, right? Behavior of one electron, maybe behavior of two electrons. But when we talk about many particle problem in quantum mechanics, then people normally refer to simulations, ab initio simulations whatsoever. And what I do not like at all is that at certain moment we're pushed to trust somebody who performs simulations and just tell you, that's what I get. Yes, take it. Yeah, because that's what my simulator gives me. And this is a moment when I lose, so to say, self-confidence, first of all, because I do not understand what is in the black box. So and then the most important in the black box of this simulator. And what is the most important is that conversation physics stops with the claims like this. So what is the most, why we like physics, why we like to do physics is that we want to understand something. We understand something when we discuss. So and then discussion means that we have somebody who has one point of view, another person who has different point of view, and truth is somewhere in the middle, right? You must have arguments to discuss, and if somebody tells you this is the result of my simulations, you can equally tell this person this is the result of my measurements, that's it. So and then the only way to solve the problem is to declare the war against each other, then the one who survives is right. So it's not the way. That's why it's very important also for this intermediate area. It's very important to develop intuitive models. This area we understand intuitively. This area, it's difficult to understand intuitively, but we got models here like Bohr model of atom, which is, if you try to publish something like this these days, You will not pass any editor with a model like, let's assume that electron is just orbiting without any reason on the orbital, or it's only allowed to jump from orbital to orbital if you excite with right energy. It's all assumptions. I mean, you must have reasons to assume this, but the model works, right? And it was the very first step to understand how the quantum world works. Because if somebody comes with a model like, imagine, electron behaves like this, then another person who sees that, okay, so if I imagine that electron behaves in this totally unexplainable way, yeah, all the spectra can be explained, all the puzzles that people had at that moment could be explained. And then another person starts to think, what would be the reason to behave for electron like this? So then, and all the physics makes perfect sense afterwards. So if you look at the development of quantum mechanics, for instance, so what people had at 19th century, it's unexplainable spectrum of luminescence from gas, right, from different gases. So they saw discrete structure in the spectra, and they tried to understand this, right? There were very few people in the world who were fascinated by these discrete spectrums. Can you imagine, like, beginning of 20th century, end of 19th century, very few people in the world struggling with this problem? You cannot, they couldn't even explain their neighbors what they're busy with, right? Anyway, so then was this model of Bohr of atom, classical model, that come with these assumptions, right? So if you assume that electron behaves like a particle orbiting and from time to time sprints to the to another orbit if you excite it with a proper energy, then it works, yeah? And then there was, of course, first discovery that electron behaves as a wave, and then people realized, well, if electron behaves as a wave, it's clear why it sits on one orbital, because it forms a standing wave. Yeah. Then at the end of the day, we can understand how atom works, but we still cannot understand how would, say, 10, 20, 30 quantum mechanical particles will behave, especially if they have interactions among themselves, right? So it's called many-body quantum problem. And absolutely in every area where you, if you type things like multi-scale modeling, you will find that people are struggling with the fact that they see something macroscopically. They understand that it should start from excitation of single atom, but they cannot find a link. Like, for instance, example of ISML. So the ISML develops mirrors that can stand very the intense radiation. So why mirror is broken? Because there is a crack, right? Crack starts with, it's basically behavior, collective behavior of atoms. I don't know if you look at the elementary excitation. So we know selection rules. How photons excite electrons, right? We understand this, then something unknown happens and there is a crack. Eh? And then what people try to do, they try to figure out what's going on here. So that's why they need these multi-scale models, and multi-scale means they aim to connect this scale with this scale. Okay? And then the common feature of everything, more or less everything which is related to this area, is the area is poorly understood. It lacks reliable models, requires multi-scale modeling. I would say modeling in general. And if you want to understand why we actually need a quantum computer, then you should look at, of course, at the behavior of a number of particles. That's why we need quantum computer. And then it means the quantum computer, we also need to understand this area. Yeah. So then, this is how I look at the physics today. And then if you want to find a big question mark, unexplored territory, or I want to say terra incognita in modern science, it all will be here. We understand one quantum particle, we understand classical physics, we don't understand this area. That's why modern physics is mainly focused on this area. Then the thing I would like to study, I would like to talk today, these are not related to size, these are related to time. Put here the time scale, femtosecond, 1 picosecond, 1 nanosecond. And how I relate time scale to the length scale, well, it's very simple at the end, because if you look at the electron at the Fermi level, for instance, the electrons that behave. The speed of electron at the Fermi energy is 10 to 5 meters per second, right? So if you look at the distance that electron travels and the time which is required to cover the distance, we will get this one angstrom would be 1 femtosecond, 1 nanometer would be 10 femtoseconds, etc., etc. So that actually, if you're talking about time scale of 1 micrometer, 1 micrometer will be somewhere at the scale of 100 picoseconds. So basically, this diagram helps to explain, helps to show that if you're interested in this unexplored territory, if you want to study this better, you can either study things at the small length scale, and this is one approach, but you can equally, you're going to have equally interesting journey studying processes at the time scale shorter than 100 picoseconds. So basically, it's all length and time are related with the speed, of course, obviously, and that it should be speed of characteristic particle. So I took speed of electron at the Fermi level, and if you look at the what else could be relevant here, where you can look at the speed of light. Or you can look at the simply behavior. I mean, you will never be able to exceed 10 to 8 meters per second, of course, because of the speed of light. And then you will be still, if you're talking about small length scales, you will be still in the range of, say, femtoseconds, nanoseconds. So then my approach would be to explore this unexplored territory. Not with the help of tools that allow you to achieve good spatial resolution, but with the help of tools that allow you to achieve good temporal resolution. Okay? How can we do this? Well, first, before we before I start to explain this, let me understand. Let me help you to understand how I see my mission here. So then I try to formulate this, that what we're trying to do is that we are working in a strong collaboration between theory and experiments, trying to develop new approximations allowing to describe these dynamics. That's important. So we try to understand what kind of approximations should be taken so that even in this range, we have intuitive models. Intuitive means that if a theoretician who does ab initio simulations show you the results, you can tell him or her it's wrong, sorry. It's against the model. So something you have in the hands to start discussion. So, and this is the very first step to have these models is, of course, to develop approximations. And in my talk, I will define word ultrafast as a process that occurs on a sub-100 picosecond timescale. Later, I will show another motivation why sub-100 picosecond timescale is so important. And in my talk, I will mainly refer to the experiments. It's not because I personally, of course, find experiment the most important thing. And I like to quote famous Soviet scientist Pyotr Kapitsa, who said, the theory is good, but good experiment is forever. It's not necessarily true for you, so you may have different opinion. I don't insist it's absolutely true. But it's just to let you know that I will be referring to experiments probably too often, and for some of you who do theory, but I'm open to talk about theory as well. And three questions I would like to answer today. So how to excite media ultrafast, how to do these measurements with time resolution, and what is most important with a time resolution which is comparable with the motion of electron within the atom, say 1 femtosecond. And what do we learn from these studies? What do we learn from these measurements? And my talk will, my presentation, well, I aim to show most of the slides, and then the presentation will consist of three parts. So mainly the first part would be to show you main experimental observations that demonstrate that the area of ultrafast phenomena is very dynamic area, so there's a lot of questions, counterintuitive questions. And the second, I will show you so the latest developments, and then the third, more or less the outlook, what is going on, where people want to develop to. And one of the goals also is to prepare you for plenary talks. So that's in particular the last talk of this conference from Rupert Huber. It is related to ultrafast science. Rupert Huber is developing new techniques, in particular new techniques for ultrafast measurements. So I will try to explain you why we need all these studies. And while trying to answer the first of these questions, I will like to start with a statement that, in fact, if you're looking for the fastest possible stimulus, then of course you should take a laser pulse. If you look at the development of laser sources over the past years, so here you can see here, this is the pulse duration. You can see that even commercial laser systems have reached now the pulse durations shorter than 10 femtoseconds. Do you know how short a femtosecond is? 15. But in physics, what does it mean in physics? What do we compare it with? It's just one optical cycle in the visible spectral range. So if you talk about time scale of 5 femtoseconds, it's just a pulse. You can imagine a laser pulse that makes 5 oscillations, that's it. So basically, if you look at the electron within the atom, it will make 5 oscillations around atom and will stop. So if you talk about condensed matter physics, it's difficult to imagine something shorter than this. Okay? So this is the shortest possible time scale. And can, that's then also we can even claim that laser pulse is the shortest stimulus in experimental condensed matter physics or in experimental physics in general. So then I would like to propose to use a laser pulse as a stimulus, right? So let's think about in terms of experiments that we want to do. Imagine that we are they're performing these first experiments with ultrafast laser. I mean, just aiming to achieve femtosecond resolution. We're aiming to find the right stimuli, right detection techniques. So the stimuli, we know what it could be. It could be a laser pulse, right? What is laser pulse? So I found some pictures on the internet. This is how pulse may look like if you have a number of cycles. So this is not, of course, not the real picture. I mean, not the real behavior of electric fields of lights. It's something that you can measure with a special type of autocorrelator. So to be honest, I've forgotten to check how it works. So that's I'm not prepared to explain you how it works, but probably it's not even needed. So the goal of this is to show you how many light wave cycles you can have in the pulse. And this is a commercial laser system. And a commercial laser system will consist of, you can see here, a number of mirrors. It's not big. The most important thing there is the pump laser. And the main trick here in observing short laser pulses is also very simple physically. Then let me check you. Let me check now how good your understanding of physics and mathematics is. If you have to generate short laser pulse, what would you do first?
Sorry.
If you want to generate very short laser pulse, what would be your first step? Yes, and why? Exactly. So the thing, it is a very good answer because it's when you do time result physics, or you do, I mean, actually it's not only limited to time result physics, it's limited absolutely to every area of physics, but in time result, it sounds like if you observe something in time domain, you don't understand this, transfer this using Fourier transform in spectrum domain, probably their understanding would be more clear. Another way around, if you're struggling with an interpretation of some spectra, try to transfer back to time domain, and probably their interpretation would be easier. It is a very, I mean, Fourier transform is a basic operation in physics. So whatever area of physics you take, it would be one of the cornerstones. So if you don't understand, for instance, distribution of things in space, if you make Fourier transform and you learn from Fourier transform, right? That's how we introduced k-vector at the end, right, for the electrons. It's again aiming to describe everything with the help of waves. The only benefit from this, I mean, not only, of course, but the one of the main benefits to introduce waves for the description of physics is ability to use Fourier transform. Because if you know how one wave behaves, you can describe everything. Because every single pattern can be described as a number of waves using Fourier transform. Whether it is time, whether it is space, whatsoever. I mean, you know how one wave behaves, you will understand everything. Okay? So you need to have sufficiently broad spectrum, because if you have short pulse, you make Fourier transform, you see the spectrum is very broad. And afterwards, you have to make sure that all the sinusoidal oscillations, they come in phase, of course, because this is the main principle of laser. So then if you take light just from this lamp and measure intensity, it will be something like this, right? Or being more precise, if you measure behavior of the electric field as a function of time. But if you take a monochromatic laser and measure how electric field from monochromatic laser behaves, it will be perfect sinus, right? It's monochromatic radiation. But if you look at the behavior of electric field here, it would be sinus, but it is limited in space. Electric field, time. And if you make Fourier transform of this short pulse, you will see that it consists of many sinusoidal oscillations which come in phase. So you need to have broad spectrum and you need to lock phases of all these sinusoidal oscillations. And the trick is called phase mode locking. So that's the invention of the mode locking was one of the breakthroughs in development of femtosecond lasers. So they succeeded to bring all phases of sinusoidal oscillations to the same value. That's why they have this pulse. And then if I have short pulse, then it can work as a flash of a camera. Well, if you know the history of very first movie made, you know what was the motivation to make the very first movie? So there was a fundamental question. People who do who studied how horses are running, there was a fundamental question whether the horse takes all the four legs from the ground or not. And then what people did, they put a number of photo cameras at different points in space, and with certain delay they made pictures. And after the run, they put all the pictures one to another, and then they got movie, right? The light in this movie came with, say, microsecond flashes, millisecond flashes, maybe. In our movie, light will come with femtosecond flashes, right? So this femtosecond laser pulse we will use as a flash of a photo camera. So the only question is whether we can detect the process of interest. So here, of course, we had to make picture of a horse. But if you want to study physical phenomenon, it's also a question, well, whether light can probe physical phenomena that you want to study. And this is the place where you as a physicist can contribute a lot, because this is how you design experiments, is how you build experiments, right? And then this will greatly depend on your knowledge of physics, of course, and theory. And theory, I mean here, not simulations. Theory means something that you can prove to the rest of the team, so that you convince others to work on this problem. Otherwise, you will work alone. So this is, you can work for a couple of years, but not longer. So you have to convince people who work next to you. You have to write proposals. You have to convince people at scientific conferences that this is indeed way to proceed. And these days you cannot do experiments otherwise. So that's the days of crazy scientists who do breakthroughs in physics. Well, unfortunately, then most of the possibilities are over. So I'm not sure we can do this discoveries alone. So this all becomes a big team effort. Yeah. And anyway, so even if you work alone, it's not guaranteed that you will be understood, even if you achieved something. So it's not bad to, from time to time, check with the rest of people around you if you're doing things that others can understand, right? So then, in this case, I would like to show you that light can probe magnetism. But if you have other ideas, for instance, you're interested in your study-specific phenomenon, you want to know whether we can probe this with light. After I show you my methods, we can try and apply my method also to your case. And it's just while I explain how the our studies are performed, so you can think about right example that we can consider on the board and see how we can tackle the problem and study a certain process at ultra-fast time scale. Okay, so I will take the case of magnets. So why magnets? Let me briefly introduce magnetism and why I personally find it very interesting. So magnetism, although we know magnets from, people know magnets from ancient times. So this is a very old object. As I was applying once for American visa, I was asked what is the purpose of going to the United States. I said conference on magnetism, magnetic materials. So at that time, people make jokes, and a woman there at the American embassy said, "Well, sounds magnetic." So that's magnetism is magnetic. So this is a nice example. But why I personally like magnetism fascinating, it is that the fact that breakthrough and understanding of magnetism came with the development of quantum mechanics. So if you look 100 years back, so people had very rough ideas why magnets have this magic force and can attract other objects. People knew that, for instance, they could build magnets using an electric current, but they had no idea where these electric currents come from if you just take a piece of iron. And then with the development of quantum mechanics, they realized that electron may have spin, right? So the discovery of spin is 1920s, around that time. So there's people started to think first that there must be fourth quantum number. And then people also realized that if you look at the Coulomb interaction and quantum mechanics, Coulomb interaction quantum mechanics is actually spin dependent. So it means that if you have two electrons, then the energy of two electrons with antiparallel spins would be different than energy of two electrons with arbitrary alignment of spins. And they started to call this interaction, which is in fact just spin dependent part of the Coulomb interaction, they started to call it exchange energy. So there is no special force here, it is just Coulomb interaction, but the spin dependent part of it. And the simplest way to write to define Coulomb interaction is to define it like a scalar product of two spins times some constant. It is not like it is in reality. In reality, exchange interaction can be much more complicated than this. It's just the simplest way to describe this. As a matter of fact, in most of cases, it is sufficient. But if you want to go further in physics, you have to look for the cases where you can break this, right? So Heisenberg suggested that the simplest way to describe this interaction would be this. You cannot describe it in a more simple way, right? This is the lowest possible order with respect to spin when such that the defining energy in this case still makes sense. It cannot be. Energy cannot be of the first order with respect to spin, by the way. Do you understand why? If I say energy is linear function of spin of electron, would you believe me? No? I had it, by the way. I had it with one theoretician. He's one ab initio theoretician who does ab initio simulations, tried to convince me that it's possible. So then there is a very simple trick. It's called time reversal. So if you make change of your coordinate system, like time reversal, and if you assume that there are no dissipations, so it means entropy doesn't change, and then you can basically see in your problem if there are dissipations or not, then time reversal shouldn't change anything, right? Because positive direction of time should be equivalent to the negative direction of time. Yes or no? So it's only the only thing that limits us to reverse time in physics is the second law of thermodynamics that says that entropy cannot increase. So decrease, sorry. Entropy can only increase. Well, sorry, I just spent the whole morning correcting exams on thermodynamics, so I started to make mistakes on ourselves. I saw all possible answers. So the entropy can only increase. And if you assume that entropy doesn't change, positive direction of time and negative direction of time should be equivalent in physics. So what I do, I imagine I make a movie of a process, then I write movie backwards, and if I see the very same picture, it's called the process is insensitive to time reversal, right? If I make time reversal, so the spin will reverse its sign, right? Because spin is spin, right? If I make time reversal, it will be movie another way around. Energy not. So the terms which are proportional to spin, terms and energy which are proportional to the odd powers of spin make no sense. So, and there is no single ab initio simulation that would convince me in the opposite, because it's basically changing the coordinate system, that's it. Right, it's a symmetry. Then, if you look at the exchange force, this exchange energy that acts between the spins, and looking at the force is very, it's relatively simple in magnetism, it can be represented by effective magnetic field. So effective magnetic field with which spin acts on its neighbor would be derivative of energy with respect to spin. Later I will explain you once in more detail why it is like this. But the effective magnetic field that you will get in this way would be from 100 to 1000 Tesla. So as we know, that it's a huge field, right? 1000 Tesla you can generate only through explosion. 100 Tesla you can generate in pulsed fields, so the DC fields, so the fields that you apply with electromagnets. So in Nijmegen we have first the one of the strongest magnets, so in the Netherlands 38 Tesla, so that even you can see these movies that even frogs can levitate and drop down. But this, of course, is one of the simplest experiments you can do with the magnets. So these are huge fields acting between the spins, and these fields would be different to generate just with an electromagnet. And if you look at the Larmor precession of electron in these fields, it would be between 30 femtosecond and 300 femtoseconds. What I like to repeat is that if you want to study quantum physics, you don't need to go to millikelvin temperatures, because magnets is the strongest quantum mechanical phenomenon on this planet. Iron stays magnetic even above 1000 Celsius. So magnetism that originates from quantum mechanics magnetism can survive extremely high temperatures, even human beings cannot survive. So if you want to study quantum mechanics, this is quantum mechanical object. It's true, it's too challenging, but you cannot say that this is not quantum. It is quantum, it is object for physics, probably not today, not tomorrow, day after tomorrow, when people learn how to study billions of behavior, billions of quantum mechanical particles, or maybe somewhere in between, if you learn how 100 particles behave, you can understand how magnets behave. But this is the right quantum object, and this is the object which represents a real challenge in science. And what I do not understand why sometimes when people say show behavior of one particle, they confirm fundamental physics that you can find in quantum mechanics, and they find it as a breakthrough. So because I can quote again the physicist that I quoted already at the beginning, Piotr Kapitsa, who said, if your experiment confirmed theory, there was no reason to do this experiment. Okay? So this is a real quantum, that's why I like magnets. This is a very challenging but real quantum object. And there are two types of magnetically ordered materials in the world, ferromagnets, and that means that J is positive, and then all the spins would be pointing in one direction. That corresponds to the minimum of energy. Antiferromagnets, the minimum of energy would correspond to the mutual antiparallel alignment of spins, and there is one object in between, it's called ferrimagnet. You can see here the alignment is antiferromagnetic, but the spins are not equivalent here. Such that if you look at this case, it will have net magnetic moment. Here, there would be no magnetic moment, no magnetization. And here, there would be some small magnetization. And then next thing is that why we use ultrafast, why we are so much interested in ultrafast. So it's time already to bring you to time scale and magnetism. Imagine I want to control magnetization of a ferromagnet. Just, I want to switch it. So just purely fundamentally, I don't need to motivate why, but if you want to convince a taxi driver in the importance of your research, you can say this is an elementary process in data storage. Or magnetism is still the cheapest and the most reliable way to store information. Also, our laptops already do not have a hard drive. All the magnetic memory now is shifted to the clouds, and where say magnetism is still the mean to store information. So the most reliable information on this planet is stored magnetic, the most important information is stored magnetically. And then magnetism, as I said, is the only reliable way to store this. Well, by law, for instance, it's a law in the bank. It's in all the banks that all important information is stored even on the tapes, not even hard drive. And tape, because you can easily reconstruct the information if a part of the recording is gone. Well, so I want to reverse magnetization. If you want to reverse magnetization, you have to remember that magnetization is an angular momentum, basically. The spin is an angular momentum. Magnetization appears because electron is a charged particle. So that's, if charged particle spins, it will produce magnetic moment. And you use conservation of angular momentum, and it says that you can change your angular momentum in time, and the speed of the change will be proportional, would be equal to the torque, will be proportional to the torque, equal to the torque, yes. And in this case, it will be proportional to the vector product of the magnetization and the magnetic field that you apply. So here written effective magnetic field. Why effective? I will explain you in a moment. But before, I want to make the point. I want to make the point that when you describe magnets in terms of magnetization, when, as people do, yeah, from the very beginning of magnetism, you make a very important step here. It's called macrospin approximation. So if we come back to the again to the 30s of 20th century, when people realized that magnet is a quantum mechanical object. Of course, at that time, they had no chance to understand how this many-body quantum mechanical object behaves. So they introduced a magnetization, which is called macrospin. It means that they sum up all the spins divided by volume, and they got a bigger object. Bigger object is a classical object. That's why we're going to apply methods and laws of quantum classical mechanics here, in particular, this law. But this macrospin approximation works well only on a time scale much longer than the characteristic time of the exchange interaction. The characteristic time of the exchange interaction I defined as the time of Larmor precession of spin in a magnetic field of its neighbor. Right? So we can assume that spins know their neighbors only after they had enough time to interact with them. Right? If it was not the case, you cannot use this approximation. And what you should do, I don't know. That forms an unexplored territory in physics of magnetism. You can look at this also differently. You can say this is time scale. I excite medium on the time scale of femtoseconds. I can use theory, conventional theory of magnetic phenomena only after 100 picoseconds, because only after 100 picoseconds medium will have enough time to come to thermodynamic equilibrium or quasi-equilibrium. Why I need this thermodynamic quasi-equilibrium is because magnetism, nowadays theory of magnetism, is based in a large extent on macrospin approximation, adiabatic approximation, and many of the quantities are defined thermodynamically. If you want to describe what's going on the time scale faster than 100 picoseconds, faster than the medium arrives at thermodynamic equilibrium, you very often have to develop new language. So what I like to repeat here, if between 100 femtoseconds and 100 picoseconds, you have terra incognita of modern magnetism. And I would like to show you with a few examples that the phenomena that you observe, there could be very counterintuitive. Just a story for a taxi driver, so I'm not like I'm a big fan of these things, but it's sometimes it works, yes, to convince other people that this is important. If you look at the development of technology, that if you look, for instance, in the magnetization reversal and why it is important, you will see that this is an elementary process in hard drives. It is it corresponds to recording of one bit of information, magnetic random access memory. And if you look, the pace with which all these devices have been developing over the last 50 years, you see that they're now reaching 100 picoseconds. They cannot go faster. And if you dream about ever faster magnetic random access memory or hard drive or whatever drive that records information magnetically on this time scale, you have to understand this physics. So we are now have approached the goal, the limit of classical physics, and we are aiming to make a next step into this unexplored territory. And if you understand how this works, or probably 50 years from now, we will get totally different electronics. So probably it will not be even electronics. Totally different world. Yeah. But if somebody knows you, that is one of the important things you can learn here. Not physics, probably, but how to respond to questions like, okay, so what is your research important for? So what would be the profit? So like, imagine the politicians will ask you, well, what is the profit? Just keep in mind, you don't need to tell them exactly the roadmap, how your discovery would be developed from now to iPhone 20, I don't know, or now from computer whatsoever. Just tell them, listen, imagine we are in 1930. Yeah? People discovered semiconductor. What was a semiconductor at that time? Semiconductor was in between dielectric and the metal. And all the technology was based either on metals that conducted current or dielectrics that were working as isolators, and semiconductors were just in between. So if you are very pragmatic, if you think in terms of like tomorrow, yeah, how can I get the profit of this thing today? If you think, well, as you can see, I'm from one of the left universities in the country. So if you like to say capitalists will want from you, they want profit tomorrow. So we want that all people on this planet improve, the level of life on this planet is improved. So you have to think much further than this. Avoid this and then tell them, in 30s of the 20th century, nobody would imagine a revolution in electronics that came 20 years later. When Kimel and Onnes was studying liquid helium, again in 20s, nobody was thinking about application of liquid helium in MRI scans, magnetic resonance imaging, in hospitals. Yeah? So these things, this is a real breakthrough, because we even cannot imagine what will lead to. And the most important is that you are able to convince other people that this is interesting. And one of the, so to say, tricks to do this is to show how the science was developing, what are the problems that science meets now, what are the challenges today, and how you're going to go beyond state of the art, right? And if it leads to technology tomorrow or not, it's not important. It's better doesn't lead to technology tomorrow, because in most these proposals are normally not granted even, because it's very easy to say, ah, it will not work. It's you ask money for 3 years, 5 years, right? You're asking 600,000, that would be more or less the level of the grant that you will ask first. Ah, it's too little there for such a big, ambitious project. So stay realistic. The realistic goal is, physics was developing in this way. It now faces the problem. You're going to solve this problem. Maybe in future, in 50 years, it will lead to this technology, right? So you're allowed to have a dream, but don't put this literally in the proposal. Because it's sort of a dilemma you have to play always. You have to convince it's important, but do not promise too much because nobody will believe you. That's why if I have to defend this story, I always put question mark. And then the game, the rule of the game is following. Say, whether it is possible or not, well, partly it also depends on you. Well, then how to generate, how to study this unexplored territory. So if you talk about magnetism, I made here an overview of all possible stimuli that, of course, you can use electromagnet, but the pulses are way too long. People developed a very special trick here. It's called photoswitch. And it's a very clever trick. So they apply voltage to this electrical circuit. They make a microcoil. And so I didn't take a pointer. So this is a microcoil. And then they put sample in here in the middle. And then they made made a cut, so to say, in the circuit, so that the current doesn't flow through by a piece of semiconductor. But when we shine light on this piece of semiconductor, you generate non-equilibrium charge carriers. Then there is a shortcut then through the semiconductor. Current goes through, and it produces short pulse of currents. This scheme produces short pulse of current. And the short pulse of current, according to the Ampere's law, will produce the magnetic field. Funny thing that even Stanford linear accelerator was used at the end of 90s, in the 20th century, to study ultra-fast magnetization dynamics. And here, Stanford linear accelerator is a thing for high-energy physicists. So they had here bunches of relativistic electrons. A bunch of relativistic electrons may produce magnetic field as well. So the magnetic field pulses produced with this thing were in the range of, say, a couple of picoseconds. Could be shorter also. But the laser pulse, of course, is much more accessible than this unique installation. So why don't we use a laser pulse to control magnetism? Then the next question, can light act as a magnetic field? So at this point, I am ready to explain you my method, which is based on thermodynamics. And when we use thermodynamics, well, first we have to make clear what we're going to talk about. So the very first thing is to write first law of thermodynamics in a very abstract form, where this is internal energy change, this is work performed at the system, and this is heat supplied from the environment to the system. In the case of magnetism, the energy performed by the environment on the system is defined in this way. Like H is a magnetic field and dm is a change in the magnetization, in the magnetic moment. Then if you look at the expression above, where I put effective magnetic field, this is the most important part in thermodynamics. This effective magnetic field is defined as a derivative of internal energy with respect to the magnetization. At this place, many people start to complain, even my colleagues. So they say, well, it's not real magnetic field. Well, of course it's not real magnetic field, but I'm not interested, is it real or not? I'm interested in something that acts on the magnetization, right? Let's make a step back and think about mechanical analogy. So think about ball and the profile like this, and what would be the force that acts on the ball? We define this force in mechanics as a derivative of potential energy, right? So it means that if ball comes here downhill, potential energy would be decreased and the ball will find minimum potential energy which corresponds to the equilibrium. The work performed by mechanical force on the system is equal to force times displacement, right? The only difference between magnetism and mechanics is just in the notations, right? Because force, the role of force in magnetism is played by magnetic field. The role of response in magnetism is played by the magnetization. You will ask me, how do I know that magnetization times magnetic field will give me energy? The answer is extremely simple. We, so to say, overlook these things when we study physics, but magnetization was defined such that if you multiply it with magnetic field, it will give you energy. Right? All the forces in thermodynamics and forces and responses, they are defined such that if you take this their product, it gives you energy. And if you study new phenomena and you define quantities like force and response, or if you just define response, right, in a way you like, always keep in mind whether you can find force such that if you multiply this response on the force, it will give you energy. If not, your theory will have big problems because you cannot apply any single law in physics anymore because this observation, your variable, your observable is not related to any energy anymore. It loses most of sense. So when you thinking about definition of new observable, new variable in physics, think always about force such that force times this response gives you energy. And if it's the case, you can use thermodynamics. And this is really the case in magnetism. And you can define the very same thing for the electric field and polarization. Or what else? Well, whatever. phenomena you're talking about, say, just keep in mind that the force times response gives you energy. Yeah. So I'm a little bit running out of examples at the end of the day. So that's so now we write this energy for the effect of magnetic field on the medium. But now I want to understand how light acts on the medium. So I write this first law of thermodynamics. Then I assume that I'm talking only about processes which are reversible. So it means that there are no irreversible processes in the system. It's not a big assumption, but it simplifies. It doesn't mean that it has a big many consequences for the rest of the theory, but it allows us to simplify considerations further. So this is entropy, and it means that the Q supplied to the system is equal to zero. Then work performed on the system by light. Well, here, very important approximation is electric dipole approximation. So what I assume is that when light interacts with medium, it interacts mainly with electrons by its electric field. If you ask me why I think so, well, it's if you look at the numbers, interaction of electric field with electrons has simply higher energy than interaction of magnetic field with spins. And light is electromagnetic wave. There is nothing else but electric field and magnetic field. So one of these two components should dominate. It is a matter of fact, electric field interacts much more in a much more intense way with electrons than magnetic field with spins. So energy of interaction of electric field with electrons is higher than energy of interaction of magnetic field with spins in the medium. So I assume that it is electric field that performs the work, and the same as I did in the same way as I did before. If electric field is a force, then the response is defined such that electric field times the force time response gives me energy. And this P is so-called electric polarization. Then the question is, well, electric polarization is obviously induced in the medium by electric field of light, right? How do I know what kind of polarization light induces in the medium? Any ideas? So I always make a joke at this point. There are just two options for this dependence. Linear and nonlinear dependence. So in the simplest case, it is a linear dependence, such as to satisfy SI units, international system of units. I write an expression like this. And chi is optical susceptibility. It is a tensor that gives me flexibility, such flexibility is that polarization induced in the medium is not parallel to the electric field, which I apply. It's the most general case in the case of anisotropic medium. If medium is isotropic, the expression becomes much easier. Chi, this optical susceptibility, is just a scalar. Just if you are looking for link of optical susceptibility to the rest of physics of light matter interaction, then optical susceptibility plus one, I can remind you, this is dielectric permittivity. And refraction coefficient in square, it is equal to the dielectric permittivity. Okay? So then the next approximation is a linear optical approximation. So you assume that the dependence is linear. And if you write, I did, this in a more general form. So for the form of anisotropic medium, for every component, you can write an expression like this. And well, in physics, in scientific papers, when people write this expression, they very often omit this term just for simplicity. They understand it should be there, just to make it shorter. It's not present in the formula, so don't try to put numbers there. But if you want to put numbers, just remember that there is this sum term here. So I will do the same. I will skip this term. Then you write the expression for the energy of light matter interaction. You take the integral. You will arrive to well-known formula. Energy of light matter interaction and electric dipole approximation is equal to the epsilon zero optical susceptibility electric field in square. By the way, another question. Is it possible that light matter interaction is a linear function of the electric field? What do you think? My question is no. Do you know why? So I take an integral. So I take a sinusoidal field. We know that light from laser is sinusoidal. The electric field from laser has a sinusoidal form. Take an integral from minus infinity to plus infinity, I will get zero. And light matter interaction is not zero. So it's not allowed. So the energy is a square, or at least square with respect to the electric field of light. Then I write the expression for the internal energy. And here I make a trick. So there will be part which doesn't depend on the electric field of light and the part that does depend on the electric field of light. And then afterwards, I get very simple expression for the optical susceptibility. Thermodynamic definition of optical susceptibility. And taking this expression and definition of effective magnetic field, something that acts on the magnetization in the medium, and something that acts on magnetization in the medium is derivative of internal energy with respect to the magnetization, I will get this expression. So basically shows you that if magnetic properties of media depend on the magnetization, light can act as effective magnetic field. So it can't simply do the job of an electromagnet. So do you believe me now that light can work as a magnetic field and switch magnetizations in the media? So the next question, yes?
Isn't it just more straightforward to think about relativity and the fact that a magnetic and electric field are the same thing?
No, these are not the same thing. They are electric and magnetic field. They have different symmetry with respect to time reversal. And they have different symmetry with respect to space inversion. So these are by far not the same thing.
I just remember this statement that a magnetic field is a magnetic field just in a different time frame, a different observation frame.
Well, you still need a current to get, say, if you have electric fields, it should have a specific geometry to get magnetic fields, right? To get, yes, and you need motion for the...
Yeah, for a moving charge.
Yes, yes, and you need motion for the magnetic field. Yeah. If there is no motion, there would be no magnetic field. Yes?
I always have trouble to kind of relate optical susceptibility to magnetic susceptibility. So does that last formula mean that they are the same or
no?
This
so at the moment we said we work in electric dipole approximation, we forget about magnetic susceptibility, we assume it's one. So it doesn't depend on any, basically we are not interested in that quantity at all because the interaction we are focused on is interaction of electric field and charges, so it means only what the only thing that happens in the medium is electric field induces polarization, electric polarization. And magnetic susceptibility would be relevant if you work in magnetic dipole approximation. So a magnetic field induces magnetization. Okay. So here only electric susceptibility is important, and then this expression, very simple expression, tells you that if you find a medium for which magnetic properties, magnetization can affect optical properties, then in this medium you can expect that light will work in absolutely the same way as magnetic field does. So how does this susceptibility depend on the magnetic field? Well, let me go faster through this. Well, I first repeat this statement. I'm working with the cases when entropy doesn't change. So there are no irreversible processes in the medium. Then, this you have to believe me. So if you look for the case when there are no dissipations in the medium, it means that all the energy that comes from light and arrives, so to say, to the medium from light, it should leave the medium. There's nothing left in the medium after the light-matter interaction. You can assume, you can look at the Poisson vector. So S here is also, oh, source. Did it? I took another thing. So does it made mistake, pushed the wrong button. So then here on my slide, S this vector is a Poisson vector. So if you calculate, if you look at the Poisson vector and look at the divergence of Poisson vector, I by a mistake pushed the video.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
I was looking for that.
If you look at the divergence of Poisson vector, you can demonstrate that if this divergence is zero, and it must be zero because I said there is no irreversible energy transfer from light to matter, then you can find that optical susceptibility should be Hermitian tensor. Just it's very simple but very long derivation, but you can you will see you will find it in many cases that if you want to get, for instance, in quantum mechanics, energy as a real number, then the Hamiltonian should be Hermitian, etc., etc. It's the same here. So that if S with a vector sign on top is a Poynting vector, so you can we can derive from that expression that its optical susceptibility should be Hermitian tensor. And again, this is the point when people very often complain. They say, well, no, wait a moment, this is not possible. This approximation, no dissipations, forget about it. It never happens in the world, in the real world. Not true. Yeah. So also, people claim there is always absorption, because they claim that they're basically the same as saying, the world is not ideal. There will be always a small fraction of absorption. The thing is whether this defines what's going on in the process or not, if it is a side effect or it is the main effect. Let me give you one example. So this is a spectrum of absorption coefficient and refraction coefficient of quartz. I took from internet. You can see that, for instance, at this wavelength, absorption coefficient is zero. So it means if you calculate divergence of Poynting vector, you will get zero. There's no absorption. Refraction coefficient is not zero, is not one. So it means it doesn't behave as a vacuum. It interacts with medium. Absorption is zero. Refraction is not one. So it means there is a fact of light-matter interaction, but there are no dissipations. So I'm allowed to use this approximation then of no dissipations. And how it looked like in quantum mechanics, it is even more familiar than people think. It would correspond to off-resonant excitation of two-level system. So if you excite two-level system off-resonantly, there would be no absorption, right? But there is effect of light-matter interaction. If you treat light-matter interaction properly, not using Einstein coefficients, but properly writing like dipole moment, electric field, Bloch equations, or any other equation that describes interaction of electric field with a charge, you cannot claim that if you excite electronic oscillator, right, with electric field, if electric field oscillates not at the frequency, eigenfrequency of the oscillator, you cannot claim there is no interaction. There is interaction. Just the thing is that as soon as you stop exciting the electron will stop as well, right? And it would correspond that to the situation that there was no energy transfer from light to the system. Everything what you gave to the system will give you back. But there would be interaction. And so since it goes slow now, yes, I will skip these parts. I will tell you immediately, we'll go immediately to the main trick, how to figure out how optical susceptibility depends on the magnetization. And here, the trick is very simple. That's why I like it so much. So then this is thermodynamic definition of the optical susceptibility. So let it be KL. Yes, KL. KL. What I do, I use the fact that there are no dissipations, right? So it means that positive direction of time should be equivalent to the negative direction of time. And I'm going to benefit from this fact. I'm going to reverse time. And if you reverse time, something that was electric field with positive direction of time would correspond to the very same electric field and a coordinate system with negative direction of time but with sine of complex conjugate. Why? Well, because electric field is defined as a wave, right? And if you reverse direction of time, it would correspond to the electric field complex conjugate. The very same would happen with complex conjugate electric fields. It will lose this sign of time reversal. Magnetic field will reverse sign, because magnetic field originates from motion of charges, from spin, right? If you reverse time, spin will will spin in the opposite direction, right? And internal energy would correspond to the internal energy, but with the magnetization reversed. So you bring all this together, you write expression for this quantity, and it would be expression like this. Then you start substituting variables from the second law, second row, sorry. So meaning that what was Kempe's conjugate will become just normal electric field. Normal electric field will become complex conjugate. Internal energy is the same internal energy, but with magnetization reversed. And what we arrive to is this expression. So basically, you have permutation of indices and reversal of sign for the magnetization. There is one thing. Here I have positive time, here I have negative time. And now I remember that there are no dissipations in the medium. It means entropy doesn't change. And if entropy doesn't change, everything what happens in the positive coordinate system with positive direction of time is equivalent to what happens in the coordinate system with a negative direction of time, right? So basically it means I can forget about this variable. It doesn't make any sense. And what I have is this expression. So optical susceptibility at the positive magnetization is equal to the optical susceptibility with indices changed and the negative magnetization. Then, I benefit from the fact that optical susceptibility is an Hermitian tensor, and I can split this tensor into two parts, symmetric part with respect to permutation of indices and anti-symmetric part with respect to permutation of indices. And from all these expressions, you will see that anti-symmetric part should be odd function with respect to the magnetization, and symmetric part should be even function with respect to the magnetization. You can see it also from here that symmetric part means you change indices and the sign changes. Anti-symmetric part, sorry, it's how it's defined. Anti-symmetric part means you change order of indices and the sign of susceptibility should change. And if this is the case, this expression should work. So you can see here that, I think I go too fast. Let's go step by step, otherwise it becomes also a bit, we are reaching already the break time. Anti-symmetric part, by the definition, is defined such that you change the order of indices and the sign is changed. Symmetric part, you change the order of indices and the sign doesn't change. Then, this would be the expression for anti-symmetric part, according to this definition. This would be the expression for the symmetric part. And if you remember that this is a Hermitian tensor, so it means that if you change indices and the sign changes, sign of the susceptibility changes, it means that anti-symmetric part should be imaginary. And as you can see, I here. And the second thing is that L M. If we talk about anti-symmetric parts, it means it is minus MLK complex conjugates. Anti-symmetric M, and it is equal to A. There's a KL minus M anti-symmetric, where this step comes from the definition, from the fact that susceptibility is a Hermitian tensor, and this comes from the fact that there is this law with respect to time reversal we derived. And you can look at the beginning, at the end of this expression, you see that if you are talking about anti-symmetric part, you change the direction of the magnetization, and the susceptibility should change sign. It is very abstract thing. Well, just let me, before we make a break, let me give you an example so that it sits better in your brains, so that you remember this longer. I will give you one experimental example. But let me just limit our description with respect to first order, to the first order with respect to the magnetization. So we ignore all the terms afterwards and we focus on this first term and this expansion. And here only the term which doesn't depend on magnetization will play the role. And as you can see here, optical properties can depend on the magnetization, and magnetization will contribute to the anti-symmetric part of the dielectric permittivity, and the contribution will be linear. One final example, as I promised. It doesn't sound as something very new, shouldn't sound as something very new, because it's very similar to Hall effect. So as you know, so if instead of if you're now, in our case, if you're thinking about optical susceptibility, it is a motion of charges of electrons in the applied electric field, right? So we apply magnetization, and instead of imagine initially you had isotropic medium, and then you had a tensor which describes optical properties in XY plane, a tensor with two terms on the diagonal, and these terms would be mutually equal. If you switch magnetization, you induce additional terms which are linear with respect to the magnetization, and as we said, it goes to anti-symmetric part, right? That's what our derivation tells us. But if you think about, not about, say, theory in terms of mathematics, but if you think about in terms of experiment, and in terms of moving charge with magnetic field and without magnetic field, you can easily find an analogy. So now, forget at the moment about optical properties, just we are talking about electric fields. We apply electric field, charges will move, right, in the direction of the electric field. If you apply electric field along the y-axis, charges will move along y-axis. The tensor of optical conductivity in this case, will have a diagonal form. It means that if you apply field along X, the current will flow along X. You apply electric field along Y, the current will flow along Y, etc. But what would happen if I now switch magnetic field on? This you should know. So the Hall effect, right? And the Hall effect means that there would be deviation of charges. There would be Lorentz force deviation of charges. And it means that if you apply electric field along Y, you will get current along X. You apply electric field along X, you will get current along Y. And in terms of conductivity, it means you will get off diagonal terms, which are, by the way, linear with respect to the magnetization. What we just proven in optics is the very same way, right? And the very same thing, right? You switch magnetization on, or you switch magnetic field on, instead of this motion of charges, the motion becomes slightly like this, okay? And it corresponds to induction of off-diagonal components. What we have proven, that's what we showed from point of view of thermodynamics without relying on any knowledge of physics or Hall effect whatsoever. Simply by symmetry, this effect should be there. And it helps you a lot, again, if you talk with theoreticians. You have your theory, which doesn't depend on the basically on specific contents. It doesn't depend on microscopic nature of your medium. You just use thermodynamics, you use symmetry arguments, and you know that this effect should be there. You cannot calculate the value of this effect, you cannot tell the number, but from symmetry point of view, you know this effect should be there. And other effects may be even forbidden. Okay, and I had it, this is a thing to say at the masterclass, I had it several times talking with people who do ab initio simulations. They claim effects which are forbidden by symmetry. Well, let's make a break at this point, 15 minutes. Yes, and then we'll continue. It's good. So, shall we continue? So we'll go a bit faster now. So this is the expression for the effective magnetic fields, which we derived. I showed you that, in principle, this is very simple expression to understand. If your properties, if optical properties depend on the magnetization, then light should be able to induce magnetic field. You put here the numbers. Not the numbers even, but that you try to put here the expression for the term of the optical susceptibility that depends on the magnetization. We will get expression like this. And you can see here, since you have magnetic field, you want to get real number here, then this term then should be imaginary, such that this imaginary term times I will give you a real number. And you see that if you want to get effective magnetic field here, you should put here something like 1 in I. And then if you think about electric fields with X, 1, and Y should be I, it would correspond to circularly polarized light. It would be something like Y component oscillates with phase 0, and X component oscillates with phase pi over 2. So that means that if you look at the oscillations, it will behave like this. For right-handed circularly polarized light and for left-handed circularly polarized light. And if you put this expression for right-handed circularly polarized light here, you will see that magnetic field is in one direction, and this expression for left-handed circularly polarized is the very same expression. You will see that effective magnetic field will be induced in the opposite direction. So very simple. So if you have circularly polarized light, simply by symmetry, it should act as a magnetic field. And, well, this I will skip. This is the conclusion for the first part. If we find that a certain process can be launched and monitored with the help of light, we can study ultrafast dynamics of the process. The ways for optical excitation detection can be predicted thermodynamically. Well, this I skipped, so the dissipations may have effect on the time scale at which you affect the medium. but let's focus on these two. So then, main thing, if you want to study ultra-fast process, you should use lights, but it means also that you should be able to launch the process with help of light and detect the process, detect a quantity of interest with the help of light. I demonstrate in the case of magnetism that it is possible to affect magnets and to detect magnets with the help of light. Okay? Probably it's not that clear that we can detect magnetism with the help of lights, but, well, from the previous expression, let me emphasize that the expression that we showed here, if optical properties is a function of the magnetization, and otherwise this derivative would be zero, right? If optical properties is a function of the magnetization, then it means that magnetization can change optical properties, and if you detect this properly, you will be able to trace magnetization in the medium. In fact, this is the fact that light can monitor magnetization in the medium is called magneto-optical Faraday effect. Has anybody heard about magneto-optical Faraday effect? So do you know which role this effect, what kind of role was played by this effect in the development of electromagnetic theory of Maxwell? So this is something which we all can learn from history of physics. If you look at the original paper of Maxwell, what he did there, he basically summarized all the findings that have been done before, like if you have alternating electric field, it can generate magnetic field. If you have magnetic field, it can generate currents. So basically, he summarized laws of electromagnetic induction, law of Ampere. And he also made very important hypotheses. He said that we assume that light is electromagnetic wave. Why did he do this? Well, of course, it was known already at the time of Maxwell that light is a sort of vibration. So it's light is a thing, is a substance that can propagate. From the experiments of Huygens and Newton, people knew that light is sort of wave because they observe diffraction, they observe interference, right? But they didn't know the nature of this wave. That's why at that time people thought that light is a special type of matter. And Maxwell was the first one who proposed that light must be an electromagnetic wave. Why did he do this? Because Maxwell had on his desk discoveries of Faraday, discoveries of Ampere, and statement that light must be the wave. And then this discovery of the Faraday effect, played a key role there. What Faraday did, I don't know what was the motivation for these experiments. This is, again, the beauty of experimental physics. Sometimes we do crazy things which change the world. Right? So he was playing with polarized light, propagating through medium in applied magnetic field. And what he found, that when polarized light propagates through medium, polarization of light rotates. And this angle of rotation is proportional to the magnetic field of the magnetization of the medium. To the magnetization of the medium. And then what he said, there is an effect produced on polarized ray, and thus magnetic force and light were proved to have relation to each other. But then now think, it was known that light is a sort of vibrations. It was not known the nature of these vibrations, and he found that these vibrations can be affected by magnetic fields. So then he proposed that, okay, if I can affect vibrations by magnetic field, it must be somehow very similar to moving charge, or I don't know, something electrical should be present. Then he made this hypothesis and proposed that light is an electromagnetic wave. It can propagate, obviously, because it's wave. It has very small wavelength, and wavelengths we knew already from the experiments of Newton and experiments of Huygens on diffraction. And he made a suggestion, he made a hypothesis, that there must be also other electromagnetic waves of different wavelengths. And it was the motivation for Hertz to perform his experiments and demonstrate indeed that there are also electromagnetic waves of different wavelengths. Yeah? And then if you look at the books, it is basically Hertz who is mentioned as a person who discovered electromagnetic waves, but actually, if you look at the development of physics in time, this effect played a key role. So this was a real discovery. This was something that changed the world. It's something like, it's comparable to the discovery of the fact that electron is a wave. He found that light has a it can interact with magnetic field. Okay? So then, this fact corresponds again from the fact that originates from the fact that magnetic optical properties of light can be changed by magnetization, and in fact we can show easily that this susceptibility alpha that we put in the expression for the effective magnetic field is the very same susceptibility that defines Faraday effect. That's why people call this one as Faraday effect. You can see it was discovered in 19th century, and in the 20th century people realized there should be inverse effect. If magnetic medium acts on light, then light should be able to act on the medium. That's exactly what I tried to tell you. If optical properties of medium depends on the magnetization, it should be possible to act on the magnetization with the help of light. It's direct and inverse effects. And then we make this, we now have the puzzle completed. We can launch magnetization dynamics with a short laser pulse. We can probe magnetization dynamics with a short laser pulse. Do these type of experiments, what we call in physics pump and probe experiments. So we send one pump, it's a flash of a camera, and we send the probe, so to say. We send the pump. I already made mistakes with the second half of the lecture. Pump launches certain process in the medium, launches dynamics of interest, for instance, acts on the magnetization, and we send the probe, and probe plays a role of flash of photo camera. And then we make a picture. So in reality, the experiment looks like this. So we have a laser, then the laser pulse splits into two parts. One is used to excite medium, another one is used as a flash of photo camera to make picture. And then we send these two pulses along different paths, and they're focused on the sample. And then we can vary the length of one of the paths. And while you vary the length, you vary travel time of this pulse from this mirror to the sample. So my first experiment as a PhD student of the first year, I was impressed after I built this instrumental setup for the first time. I was impressed by the fact that light really has speed. So I could measure this. So you move the mirror, and you see that the prompt and probe pulses overlap at different time at different times. Yeah? at different so you, upon moving the mirror, you can see that the prompt and probe pulses overlap or not. So that's or they overlap differently. And if you look at the speed of light, if you calculate how far you should move the mirror to get delay, for instance, of 3 femtoseconds, it's just movement of 1 micrometer. It's just nothing. I mean, with present fine mechanics, you can easily get these delays. And if you move over 1 millimeter, it will be 3 picoseconds. And 3 picoseconds is much faster than electronics can work. So with this technique, you can access this terra incognita of ultra-fast magnetism or ultra-fast phenomena, just moving, just playing with mirrors and moving mirror here. And it's because you use lights, and light has the speed, well-defined speed. Well, this was one of the first surprises that we discovered. So for a long time, we were looking for the effect of light on the medium. And we found it when we already lost any belief that it's possible, because we found it absolutely unexpectedly in the material. Actually, we thought it's different material, but it's another story. But it's it more belongs to lecture about lucky coincidences. And what we found, that we can excite magnetic resonance in the medium, and the phase of the resonance was a function of the polarization of light. So here you can see oscillations are defined by the orientation of the magnetization. What we measured here is the Faraday rotation, which is proportional to the magnetization, as a function of time delay between pump and probe pulses. And you can see here, if you use right-handed circular polarized light, you have oscillation, very high frequency, left-handed circular polarized light oscillations, very high frequency. If you change helicity of light, you change the phase. So in one case, you push the spins, another case, you pull the spins. So field worked as effective magnetic field. The disappointment at this point was that the field was not strong enough. And then we measured this with respect to, we measured this with respect to the effective causes. So if you look at the oscillations have nicely sinusoidal form. And as we know, if we excite an oscillator and it oscillates following sinusoidal motion, we are very close to equilibrium. So we didn't excite it far away. So if you look at the papers and people claim we succeeded to switch magnetization from one state to another, but then they show nice sinusoidal behavior, harmonic oscillator, well, it's as crazy as claiming that you triggered large amplitude precession of pendulum, oscillations of pendulum, and these oscillations are defined by sinusoidal function. It is not true, right? So the equation for motion of oscillator or pendulum have solution as a sinusoidal function only when the amplitude is small. If the amplitude is large, you have to take unharmonicities into account. So here you can see nicely sinusoidal function. So this is harmonic oscillations. This is by far not the effect that we want to achieve in the first place to switch magnetization from state up to state up. So that was very disappointing at one hand, but on the other hand, of course, we've written at that time proposals that normal story like, well, we are now here, deviation a few degrees, and 5 years we plan to be 20 degrees, and sometime over 10 years we will be able to switch. Well, I will show you later that all these proposals very soon appeared to be useless. But then, just to convince you that probably this is not such a crazy discovery, so that's not so a useless discovery, let me show you that one Tesla within 100 femtoseconds is not such an usual thing. So if you take this so-called photo switch, which I explained you before, and you calculate electromotive force and the current that you need to get one Tesla in 100 femtoseconds, just using the law of Ampere and then law of electromagnetic induction. It doesn't work. Yeah, here it's hanging, and my slides can go from slide to slide. Ah, that's strange. So this one, just a moment. Yes, the law of electromagnetic induction. And you calculate electromotive force and the current that you need for this. You will see that electromotive force should be 200 kilovolts and the current 100 amperes. And not to mention you have to switch it on and switch it off within 100 femtoseconds. So then you understand how challenging it becomes. But with the help of light, you can generate these fields in a natural way very easily. Of course, it wouldn't be a real magnetic field, but it's the very same. It's something that changes potential energy of spin such that effect of light would be absolutely equivalent to the effect of magnetic field. And then we did many experiments playing that with many other materials showing it's very general phenomena that we could find many other media. Of course, we always had a dream whether we can switch magnetization from state up to state down. And since we are now running out of time, let me go faster through this. Come already to recent advances in ultrafast phenomena, and it allows me to show you that actually the beauty of doing experimental physics is that sometimes you don't believe your eyes. Huh? So as I said, in 2005 we published paper with very small effect of circularly polarized light on the medium. Well, we also written a number of proposals that, okay, we found unique effects, we think we can go with this further, and then maybe, and then 20 years from now we will be able to switch monetization. There were always, of course, friendly colleagues around us who would tell us, yeah, you will never be able to switch the monetization because this, this, and this reason, right? So, of course, we are... and then we also, we agreed with our colleagues, we tried to convince them, and maybe we have to study this effect better. Unexpectedly, so our PhD students came to us and said, listen, it looks like in our experiments, light switches monetization. So I said, well, it sounds weird, but if you want to prove it, you have to do the following experiment. You have to image your medium in the magneto-optical microscope, and in the magneto-optical microscope, the black domains, the black areas would be areas with monetization up, and white areas are the areas with monetization down. What magneto-optical microscope means is just a microscope in two cross polarizers, and if we have an effect which depends linearly on the magnetization, it means that one domain will rotate magnetization in one direction, another domain in the opposite direction, and you can always tune your polarizer such that one domain would be black, another domain would be white. Yeah? So this is an image of gadolinium iron cobalt in polarization microscope, polarizing microscopes in time scope. Again, I must admit, we studied this effect, this sample, having absolutely different ideas in our minds. We wanted to study something else. We didn't expect to have any effect of circularly polarized light on this material, or a very small one. And the, what we ask our PhD students to do is to excite the medium with a sequence of pulses with a repetition rate of 1 kilohertz. And then every pulse was 40 femtosecond. And the simplest experiment to do is to sweep beam very slow across the sample, such that final effects would be effect of action of many pulses. So it was just to demonstrate if it switches or not. So we took first right-handed circularly polarized light, sweep the beam, we saw switching. And it took linearly, left-handed circularly polarized lights, and they saw switching in the opposite direction. So something, as I said, you wouldn't believe your eyes, right, if you just simply follow the theory. But this is the beauty of experimental physics. If you're patient enough, one day in the lab, you see something that you do not understand, and then it means you found it. Yeah? This is your moment in science. So that was the funny thing. That was only the beginning of a very interesting journey for us. The next experiment that we performed is that we sweep beam very fast across the sample such that each of these pulses landed on the special point, on its own point. And this was the image we scanned first with right-handed circular polarized light, with left-handed circular polarized light, and we saw that single femtosecond laser pulse can switch monetization. So this is an effect of a pulse of a 40 femtoseconds, this duration of 40 femtoseconds. Well, and of course, then the next thing is to see whether you can observe how this monetization switches. Then we spent quite some time developing microscope that can trace this switching, and this is the microscope that was what we call single shot imaging. So we used one single laser pulse to excite and one single laser pulse to make an image, because you cannot do otherwise. Once the medium is switched, you have to apply magnetic field to switch it back. So you cannot run this in sort of so-called stroboscopic mode, so like sending 1,000 pulses, 1,000 pump pulses, and 1,000 probe pulses, and then take an average. Because first pulse will switch magnetization, and the second pulse won't switch it anymore. So you have to re-initialize the initial states to repeat the experiment. And if you don't do this, you have to make an image in a single shot mode. So we did this imaging, and we found, again, very interesting observation that we first have a gray area here. Gray means not black, not white, and so in the middle. So it means we destroy magnetization. And then from absolutely identical images here, we have either formation of this domain with magnetization up or domain with the magnetization down, depending on the helicity of light. So it really works as a magnetic field, but the problem, which we couldn't understand at that time, why does it switch so long? This laser pulse is 40 femtosecond, and the process of switching is 100 picosecond. And actually, if you look here at 12 picosecond, you even do not see any differences. All the pictures are identical. It's all gray areas. And then we went to our friends who do atomistic simulations. And then if you are looking for a theory or simulator in the range where multiscale, where these problems could be tackled, atomistic simulations is one of the approaches. And what they did, they basically took 1 million of spins. They write, they have written a Landau-Lifshitz equation for every single spin, coupled them, then put in a very strong computer and calculated. And they found, and then what they did also, they simulated medium in a thermodynamic way, meaning that we have 1 million of spins. They are put in a hot bath, and this bath represents free electrons. And this bath of electrons is coupled to another bath, which represents lattice. Heat capacity of electrons is much smaller than heat capacity of the lattice. That's why if you excite electrons with light, temperature of electrons goes up. And these are results of simulations. So that the principle could show that depending on the effective magnetic field from light, you can either switch magnetization or not. And the switching indeed occurs on a longer time scale, much longer than 40 femtoseconds. The problems here were that the effective magnetic field that they had to switch here was 20 Tesla. It's a bit on a higher side, so it's comparable already with, it's not equal, but comparable with the change interaction. The change interaction, as I said, is the strongest force in magnetism. Field had to be present 250 femtoseconds, otherwise this field should be even stronger. Why is it such that 40 femtosecond pulse comes, excites metal at room temperature, and metal remembers for 200 femtoseconds still polarization of light? Well, it was also a question mark, because as we all know, the coherence of electrons in the metal at room temperature is very fast. It takes just a few femtoseconds. So it takes just a few femtoseconds before electron meets another electron and forgets phase of light with which it was excited. And here, in this experiment, we also looked only at iron, because we performed measurements in the visible spectral range, and we didn't see gadolinium. We only could see iron. It's just physics of this material such that iron dominates optical properties of gadolinium iron core. And then the funny thing, it's again a surprise that we had to learn in this journey. We tried to answer the third question, and we got answer on the first two. So we wanted to understand what is the role of gadolinium. And we realized that we actually have totally, our model is not complete. So the model is not totally wrong, but pretty odd in the sense that what we did, we went to synchrotron. And synchrotron allows you to do the very same measurements, pump probe measurements, but in X-ray spectral range. And in X-ray spectral range, you can see iron and gadolinium separately. By tuning the wavelength, you can either tune the wavelength of X-ray radiation to the transitions of iron or transitions of gadolinium, and this way you will measure magneto-optical effects, the same magneto-optical effect that I explained, but in the X-ray spectral range, and you will be sensitive to the different elements in the periodic table. As you know, X-ray radiation is X-ray spectroscopy is often used to define composition of materials. It's because every single element in the periodic table has well-defined transition and X-ray spectral range in your print. And what we found that gadolinium and iron, they actually have different dynamics. They do switch, but they switch at different time scale. Then we had to realize that we are talking here about ferry magnets. Material has two magnetic sublattices. They are coupled antiferromagnetically, as I explained. And sometimes they even can compensate each other, so there would be zero magnetization, because magnetization of iron and magnetization of gadolinium may have different temperature dependencies. Because we are talking about ferry magnet, as I said, it's a material with two different magnetic sublattices. They may behave differently with the temperature. So it means that you have to model this medium not as a single not as a network of one type of spins, like I did, like I showed before, only iron, but also two types of spins. Iron and gadolinium should be coupled antifermanently. And again, that's another anecdote. When we asked our friends in New York to repeat these measurements for two types of spins, first they became very unhappy because we didn't tell them that they had what they had in mind. But they said, listen, we have a big problem here because you don't apply magnetic field and magnetization switches. So no magnetic field, every time you introduce heat pulse, like here, you excite with a laser pulse, temperature of electrons goes up, then on the time scale of electron-phonon interaction, temperature of electrons goes down. This is what they see in their simulations. Magnetization of iron switches, magnetization of gadolinium switches. And this is the net magnetization. It switches every time. And this is counterintuitive because we know that if we just introduce heat, if you heat the medium, we can only destroy magnetism. Heat cannot reverse magnetization. That's what our intuition tells us, right? But if heat ultra fast, like in this case, atomistic simulations show it can reverse magnetization. And as a matter of fact, our friends who did atomistic simulations, they first thought that there's a big bug in the software. So they were very unhappy, but then we didn't tell them, we were a bit nasty in this respect, we didn't tell them about the experimental results that we had in our lab already. So we saw that after every laser pulse, magnetization switches, and in this case, laser pulse was linearly polarized. So basically, linear polarization, it's just in between right and left circularly polarized states. So it doesn't create any magnetic field, but it can switch magnetization of continuous field. It can switch magnetization of microstructures. So here we have microstructures, and it doesn't matter in which direction magnetization is directed to. Every time you hit ultrafast, magnetization is reversed. And how it works? Well, I like this theory a lot. It's a very simple picture. You have sublattice of gadolinium, sublattice of iron. If you tell me 10 years ago that this mechanism works, I wouldn't believe you. It's a crazy mechanism. You only come with an idea that a model like this may work only if you see experimental results and the results of simulations. So then what you do, you put these two spins in a hot electron bath because you increase temperature of electrons. So it's something like you put gadolinium and iron into hot bath. Then the gadolinium and iron, they feel very high temperature around them, and the magnetic order start to melt. But the thing is that since gadolinium and iron, these are different ions, the melting occurs at different timescales. It must be the case, because it's a different ion, they have different spins. Each time when we reverse spin, we have to satisfy the law of conservation of angular momentum. Simply, if you look at the process at the ultrafast timescale, they must melt at different timescales. And then they melt at different timescales. Imagine that at the moment when iron is nearly demagnetized and gadolinium is not demagnetized yet, we take the system out of the bath, and this would correspond to the case that temperature of electrons, due to the interaction with the lattice, decreases. Because lattice has a higher heat capacity, there is a transfer of heat from electrons to the lattice, so that upon this process, temperature of electrons decreases. And it means that at a certain moment, we take this system out of the hot bath, and the system should relax to one of the metastable states, one of the stable states even. And this is a state either with magnetization up or with the magnetization down. Either the initial state or the state with the magnetization reversed. And then if you look at the amount of angular momentum which you need to follow this route and to follow this route, so this route simply costs less angular momentum. And then conservation of angular momentum pushes the system to reverse the net magnetization. You see, net magnetization here was down. Here, as a result of bring the medium into strongly non-equilibrium state, magnetization becomes acquires state up, see? And here, iron should reverse magnetization such that the net magnetization still is in state up. And then each time you increase the temperature of electrons at the ultra-fast time scale, such that you bring iron and gadolinium out of equilibrium one with another, you will launch magnetization reversal. So then, recently, it was also a nice paper, so people played.
Can I ask?
Yes, sure.
So if this one state is has less angular momentum, how do you ever do the reverse then? I missed that point.
So then, so here the total angular momentum is down, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Then you put the system into hot in a hot bath. There is a melting of magnetic aura, mm-hmm. and one sublattice melts faster than another one. And it happens. It's like a normal melting. So you have an alloy. It's a mixture of two metals, yeah? You put them into a very hot bath, and it can happen that one metal melts faster than another one. Yeah? So here, it's slightly different physics in the sense that it's not about different heat capacities, but it's about different spins of the sublattices. But as a matter of fact, iron loses magnetization faster than gadolinium. Okay. Then you take the system out of the hot bath, and you let it relax. And there are two states to arrive to. Either the state was magnetization up or the state was magnetization down. And this, I claim that this route cost less angular momentum. And if you compare the final state and the initial state, you see the magnetization is reversed. And each time I will hit the medium, it will reverse its magnetization, sort of toggle switching. Heat pulse, it comes from here to here, another heat pulse back, back, and it jumps like this.
But then if one route is the favorite one, like how, if you hit it another time, then how does...
Yes, and then you start with this initial state.
Yeah.
And then it's iron again that it demagnetizes fast, and gadolinium is the opposite direction. It everything repeats, but with the opposite orientation of spins.
Okay.
Yeah? And then one small thing, why do we need circularly polarized light here? So it played with a nasty trick with us. Actually, here we measured the probability of switching as a function of fluence, and we did it for right-handed circularly polarized light, left-handed circularly polarized light, and linear polarized light. And we could see that the switching is a sort of is a process with a clear threshold and intensity. And if you tune intensity such that we're just in this range, you can see that right-handed circularly polarized light will switch magnetization and left-handed circularly polarized will not. It happens because these right and left kind of circularly polarized states of light absorb differently in the medium. Just fast answer on the question, if you have the situation that right and left kind of circularly polarized lights propagate differently through the medium, it means that they feel different absorption coefficients. According to Cramer's chronic ratio, they will also have different refraction coefficients here. According to the Cramer's chronic ratio, they will also have different absorption coefficients. So if you have optical properties that depend on the magnetization, it means that both any refraction coefficient and absorption coefficient will depend on the magnetization. So it could be that they have different spectral dependencies, but as a matter of fact, somewhere refraction coefficients for the left, right and left hand of circularly polarized light should be different, and somewhere absorption coefficients for the right and left hand of circularly polarized light should be different. Okay. Then means they simply absorb differently, and that you can tune conditions that one polarization will switch magnetization, another one will not. And the funny thing that we inspired actually our colleagues who didn't use light at all, they generated very short pulses of electric currents, and that they showed that the pulses are as short as 10 picoseconds, they could switch magnetization. So you can, in principle, you can dream about data storage of future where we don't use magnetic field anymore, but we just send the current and we flip the page. that every time we send very short pulse of currents, the magnetization should be reversed. And it works. Then, since we don't have so much time left, let me tell you a few words about latest developments. Then we have a few minutes about, say, the exercise. On the exercise. So then, if you're looking about, if you're thinking about the further development of this unexplored territory, what kind of breakthroughs we can expect? So, the, as I showed previously, next to the challenges in theory, which is I would say monumental challenge, it's difficult to imagine that theory will come suddenly with approximation that just works and describes everything. It's still a big. It is a very long way to follow for theory, and the theory should work in collaboration with the experiment and see what kind of observations come from the experiment, exactly as we showed with experiments in X-rays and found that iron and gadolinium have different dynamics. This you cannot predict in theory, but if you know it happens, you can come with the right approximations and just take it into account. Yeah? Here, I still believe that the main progress will be driven by the experiments. Your new experiments will show something that theory should take into account and then help theory to find the right approximations. One of the experimental breakthroughs is X-ray laser. So there is a big, was a big effort, European effort, to build X-ray free electron laser in Hamburg. It's called European X-Fel. So the cost of project is 1 billion, 1 day of operation is 1 million. So you can see here the map of Hamburg. There is a tunnel under Hamburg, which plays the role of an accelerator. So the electrons are emitted here on one side of Hamburg, then they're accelerated, and then they hit the target at the another side of Hamburg, generate very short pulses of X-ray radiation. And why they want very short pulses of X-ray radiation is that so far, we performed our experiments in a visible spectral range. And the wavelength is one micrometer. So it means the objects we're sensitive to are of this size. Then we're on this map or we're sitting somewhere here. But then it would be nice if you can go to this border. Yeah, but going to this border, you would need light with a wavelength of 1 nanometer, right? Otherwise, you cannot resolve these pieces which are small as 1 nanometer. And if you look at the spectral scale, at the scale of electromagnetic radiation, you see electromagnetic radiation with a wavelength of 1 nanometer is a radiation in the X-ray spectral range. Right? So that means that we have to build a machine like this. And if you look at the developments of X-ray sources and the number of photons that these X-ray sources produced, you can see from the beginning of 20th century, it got more than 30 orders of magnitude, going from one generation of X-ray sources to another one. So the third generation is the most advanced synchrotron. X-ray source of fourth radiation is a free electron laser. So very short pulses, a lot of photons. And as you know, if you ever performed optical measurements, sensitivity of the measurements is proportional to the square of the intensity. So it's the same like if you perform measurements, electrical measurements. So the sensitivity of the measurements is a square root of intensity, and then sensitivity of the measurements in the case of all electrical circuits is a square root of current, right? Because it's a basically a level of short noise is proportional to the square root of the current, right? So then the more photons you have, the more sensitive measurements you can perform. That's why we need these lasers. And then one of the first experiments we performed, it was a different laser. It was a laser at Stanford, also free electron laser. It was to have a look at the switching and gadolinium iron cobalt, and we saw that microscopic processes that actually occur when we have ultra-fast switching of the magnetization is a flow of current from gadolinium from iron-rich regions to gadolinium-rich regions. Meaning that in case of gadolinium iron cobalt, we have an alloy, and realistic alloy is not homogeneous. Somewhere more gadolinium, somewhere less gadolinium. And what they saw in this experiment, that when you excite with a short laser pulse, there is a spin polarized current flowing from iron to gadolinium. And then this is another approach to tackle the problem of ultra-fast femtosecond temporal resolution and nanometer spatial resolution, and it would be the topic of our plenary speaker, Rupert Hoover. He was developing the time-resolved STM. So this, for this, they used a special type of molecules. You can see here STM, they have a bias, and then they send pulse of terahertz radiation, and then depending on the one pulse of terahertz radiation triggered motion of molecules, another pulse of terahertz radiation was responsible for currents between the sample and the tip. And this technique, using this technique, they have been able to observe oscillations of single molecule. So you can see here resolution of two extremes and in space, and something like 1 picosecond in time. So the trend is to go towards smaller sizes, but for this we need new techniques. The problem of tabletop techniques, they are still under development, they work, but with a specific sample, they're basically proof of concept. The beauty of X-ray lasers, these have already well-established methods, and the good thing, it works as a facility. So if you have a good idea, you can write proposal and apply for beam time, and if PRP panel, so proposal review panel, find your idea exciting, you will get beam time. But it's very competitive. So it's something like 10 proposals per one beam time, approximately. Okay? So, but this is not impossible. But it's, if you have a good idea, the chances are there. So then the conclusions would be the following. So ultrafast phenomena is a rapidly developing topic in modern science. It addresses the problems of macroscopic physics and using time-resolved experiments and atomistic models in theory at the moment. The progress in the field so far has been mainly driven by new experiments. The field will be further boosted by the development of new facilities and techniques. And the take-home message that I want to make clear, that even theoretical methods are under development, so that it doesn't mean that our intuition is useless, right? So you still have, you cannot predict dynamics, so for this we need models, but we can predict final state. For instance, if in some cases, like if you act on the medium with circularly polarized light, you can say that it breaks the degeneracy between spin up and spin down. It works as effective magnetic field. It, in principle, we could see effects which we would normally expect from magnetic field, right? And following this, so just drawing these conclusions, you don't need atomistic simulations, you don't need sophisticated atomistic models, you just use thermodynamics, and your intuition starts from that. And then once you see that what thermodynamics predicts is different from what you observe experimentally, this is the point, this is the moment to focus on the problem. So, there's something interesting happening. So there we have to study a phenomenon in detail. Okay, so that's, well, sometimes we're lucky, of course, in the experiments, but don't forget that next to be to the fact that you have to be lucky, you have to realize that you're lucky. Yeah? So that many people get chance, very few of us use the chances. And then being able to realize that now you had a lot of luck in the experiment is the only method to do this is to be prepared. So you have model in your head. It's probably a wrong model, but you have it. You know at least what to expect from the medium. And what you have in your head, if it doesn't correlate with what you observe experimentally, well, go for it. This is something interesting. So this is, say, if we call it the masterclass, this is my message. So that's, at least I follow this. So I use thermodynamic models, and then it helps you to understand process intuitively. I don't claim thermodynamics is always correct, but I use it as a reference. And I know if it is not correct, this is something interesting about ultrafast physics. And or being more pragmatically, this is the way to impress your colleagues. You first confuse them, saying, well, this is what the names predicts. Do you agree? Yes, we agree. OK, this is what I observe experimentally. Okay. Now, we have a little bit of time, right? Yeah, we have 5 minutes. Now, let's consider an example. You give me an example of phenomena that you want to observe time-resolved, in time-resolved way. I tell you how to build thermodynamic theory of it. Yes, so what is your?
Crystallization.
Any other ideas? Just probably, not because it's a bad idea, but probably we can bunch them.
Melting,
yes, okay. And anything else?
So. Resistive switching?
Yes, okay, so then this is too simple, sorry. Switching may be more challenging. Well, crystallization, let me think. It's not even thermodynamics I would follow. Crystallization is changing density of medium, right? So that was density 1, it goes to density 2. Right? And if density 1 is less than density 2, for instance, right? What kind of effects can we expect from this? So we know that light-matter interaction is described, the work we formulate the system, is described like epsilon, and P is epsilon 0 chi E. If you can prove that chi is a function of density, then you have a probe, optical probe, for crystallization state.
But there is also a region of coexistence, and the first steps are happening there, and then there is no difference in density.
Coexistence of phases, okay.
Yes.
Yes, but then it's okay, this is a different thing. So that is first, you see that if you can claim that optical properties is a function of density, just you take one phase, then it means that chi1 shouldn't be equal to chi2, and in this case it's a very simple situation, then you simply look at the reflection, you should have differences, right? Then there's another thing, you're talking about first order phase transition. So it means that you will have nuclei of one phase, and the most of the medium would be in another phase. You have coexistence of the phases. That's what you mean, right? Well, just it's just a coincidence. Right now, we do experiments with, say, this first order phase transition. So in order to know that we get the signal from these nuclei of the first phase, we do double pump experiments. We send one single pump. We know that there is a certain chance to create these nuclei. And then we send a second pump. We do double pump experiments. I lose concentration already. So there is coexistence. So this is the coexistence of two states. You send first pump. You induce these nuclei, and you send the second pump, and you know that with the second pump, according to the theory of first order phase transition, these nuclei will expand, right?
If they're stable.
Well, you send them at a very short time scale. You make sure that on this time scale they will only disappear. So you separate these two pulses on the time scale as short as you like.
Sorry, what is the system? Why pump can induce nucleation?
Yes, okay, I went too fast. Melting Does it...
melting is easier.
Yeah, is, and then crystallization, if it is caused by temperature increase, right? So the pump, you tune the pump in the spectral range where it is absorbed very well. So it's what pump does, it brings heat into the system and it increases temperature very fast. Then, if you want to study dynamics, and then you want to get rid of this effect of coexistence. So there is always, if you perform normal pump probe experiments, you send pump, one chance, there's one possibility that you create new nuclei, and there is a second possibility that nuclei that already exist in the medium before arrival of this pump, they can expand, right? True? So imagine like not crystallization, well, ice and water, that is the best case, right? So let's assume we are in the state of ice. There are some, and then we are at zero temperature, there is a coexistence of ice and water. We give the pulse, and then those nuclei of water, which were already there, they will expand because we increase temperature. But also, this pump will also generate new nuclei, and we are interested on a time scale of generation of nuclei, right? That's what you want.
So if you change the time interval between these two pulses?
No. Just let's follow me. Right? You send the first pump pulse. You have mixture of ice and water. You increase temperature. There are two possibilities to respond to the first pump pulse. The one possibility is that this bubble of water will expand. Second possibility, this pulse will nucleate new bubbles of water, right? You are interested in the dynamics of this nucleation. Normally, if there was no coexistence, I will simply send here probe pulse, measure reflectivity, and the reflectivity will follow the average density in the medium, so it will follow the average volume, it will follow the volume which is occupied by water. Do you agree?
Yes.
Yes. The danger is that this pump pulse can have two effects. It can cause expansion and can nucleate new ones. You are interested not in the expansion, you are interested in the nucleation. Then the trick which I propose, but it's nothing to do with thermodynamics, just to demonstrate that there's a lot of freedom. Send the second pump and detect signal such that it will be sensitive to both pumps.
Yeah, but then it should be in a shortened time interval, right?
Yes, and then varying time, you will be able to see at what time scale these two pumps can still correlate. The effect of these two pump pulses can correlate, and in this case, you will be able to see how this, you will be able to distinguish nucleation of the of new domains and expansion of the old ones. Do you see what I mean?
But can you learn about mechanism of nucleation in this case?
Well, yes, from if you see the time scale of nucleation, sure. Because if you see that the time scale of nucleation is 1 picosecond, and it means that nucleation means that you have to move atoms, you have to increase density, and it happens in 1 picosecond, you look at the phonon modes, which have periods at least 1 picosecond, because a phonon mode has period 100 picosecond, don't expect to contribute to this process. It simply doesn't have enough time. Phonons don't have enough time to move. But you have to look at the phonon modes, which have enough time to move phonons far from the equilibrium on this time scale. But then, if you want to measure resistance, so this example, I like this example, say, because resistance can be also seen in optical properties. And what is resistance? So resistance is when you apply electric field, you generate current, right? and this is conductivity. But this is very similar to the case when you apply electric fields and you generate polarization. The only difference is that here we're talking, we're thinking intuitively in terms of DC currents, and here the frequency is equal to the frequency of light. So what I do now, I reduce frequency as low as possible such that I still have short pulses. And it appears that I can still go down to terahertz pulses and have them very short, such that the duration of the pulse satisfies the definition of ultrafast, shorter than 100 picoseconds. So one terahertz is 1 picosecond. There are means to generate pulses which will look like this, and it will be of the order of 1 picosecond. And this is the topic, by the way, of the plenary speaker, how to generate these pulses. What I have here, I have electric fields that varies on a time scale of 1 picosecond. It's a terahertz electric field. What is the difference between electric field that you apply through electrodes or electric field from freely propagating electromagnetic wave? There's no difference. So you can detect this, and it would correspond to this, right? So you take not the electric field from contacts, and anyway, it wouldn't be possible at time scale of 1 picosecond. It would be difficult to build such a scheme. But you can take electric field from freely propagating electromagnetic wave. Yeah. It will move charges, and the very same wave moves there. You will measure response using optical methods, but not measuring currents. You will measure polarization, or you can measure this, which would correspond to the conductivity. Okay. So you can elaborate the theory further, but my statement, whatever phenomenon you have in mind, it is possible to find, using thermodynamics, it is possible to find a mean to detect this optically. Well, another question, how strong it will be. So, but this thermodynamics cannot predict, then you need to do research. Okay? Just for general education, there are studies of superconductivity with time resolution, and the claims that superconductivity is possible to observe at room temperature. The problem is that it exists only 1 picosecond. So, but it's a nice study, so the nice claim. So that's superconductivity at room temperature, 1 picosecond. Fast. And then in order to detect superconductivity, they again use short laser pulses, preferably at low frequency, so as close as possible to terahertz spectral range, where they can have more analogy between conductivity and optical susceptibility. It's also a very pragmatic approach because, just let me show you this. If you think about electron, which is excited by electromagnetic wave on a time scale of the period of electromagnetic wave, and if you take into account the fact that electrons that light will excite in metals, these are electrons at the Fermi level, you can calculate how far will electron at the Fermi level travel on the time scale of the laser pulse, and you see that the higher the frequency, the shorter the distance that electrons can travel. So if the frequency in the visible spectral range, we will probe electrons moving at the time scale of nanometer. If you go to the terahertz spectral range, you can move electrons over 100 nanometers, so even 1 micrometer, depends on the mobility. And then it becomes very similar to the conductivity that you measure in the electrical measurements, in all electrical measurements. Okay? Okay, so that's it. So I hope I was able to convince you that thermodynamics is very powerful. Although the goal of the research is to show that thermodynamics is not complete. I don't say it's wrong. It's not complete. You start this with very good knowledge of thermodynamics, and then the way to figure out that this you are the lucky experimentalist to figure out the moments that you got luck is to compare your experimental results with what you expect thermodynamically. Okay? So, I think that's it. Do you have any other questions? Yes?
The sample for where you demonstrated the switching, so originally it had already domains, this
yes.
one rotation and the other rotation. Is it trivial to create such a sample?
Yeah, it's that sample, it's easy, yes. Because magnetic medium, ferrimagnetic medium, it splits into domains naturally because it corresponds to the minimum of energy. So like, you have to keep in mind that so if this is the sample, then magnetization here will generate magnetic fields and it will act on the neighbors, and then magnetic field here would be directed in the opposite direction with respect to the magnetization. That's why it's energetically more profitable to flip this magnetization. That's why the sample forms magnetic domains such that it tries to minimize net magnetization. In this respect, it is quite straightforward in ferromagnet to get multi-domain state and to control it with the help of magnetic field. For instance, if you like to move domain wall, you apply magnetic fields. If you want to move it in this direction, you apply magnetic field in this direction, and this direction, and this direction. Yeah, so it's in the opposite direction, you apply magnetic field in the opposite direction, domain wall will be moved in the opposite direction. So in this respect, I like to give this example during thermodynamics class that whether you talk about melting, crystallization, it's a first order phase transition. Sometimes it's difficult to imagine what first order phase transition is. But if it's difficult to imagine, keep in mind magnetization reversal. It is also first order phase transition. It also has coexistent domains. The beauty of magnetism is that you can control the ratio of phases just by applying magnetic field. There's no temperature increase, just a little change of external magnetic field, and you can control the ratio of phases. But the physics, from thermodynamic point of view, is absolutely the same. It's first order phase transition. With coexistence of phases, with hysteresis, the only difference is that in the case of crystallization, it is temperature which is changed. In the case of magnetic phase transition, it's magnetic field which is changed. Yes?
I had a question. So you said that it would be a very nice way to judge what the theorists say, right? You have this things that are forbidden from symmetry. But I could imagine that the theorist would then just say, yeah, all the assumptions that you did to arrive at your, that they are just wrong, so we have to change those. And then what do you say?
Yes, but then we know we are not, that's a good question, yes? We know why we made these assumptions. For instance, we made assumption of a linear optical approximation because electric fields that were applied, they are much smaller than interatomic electric fields, so that means that we don't move electron far away. So you must have reason to claim that there is non-linearity. It means that you have to move electron further away from equilibrium. It's one of the answers. If you talk about non-dissipative approximation, so this is approximation that causes most of the questions. Then there is a Kramers-Kronig ratio that says if you can explain medium without dissipations, and you know how it behaves with certain spectrum of refraction coefficient, Kramers-Kronig ratio says that if you know spectrum of refraction coefficient, you should know the spectrum of absorption coefficient. These are two coupled things. You cannot just ignore, you cannot make them independent. If you're talking about approximation of electric dipole approximation, yes, again numbers. We are in the visible spectral range. We work at the range where electric dipole transitions are much stronger than magnetic dipole transitions. That's why we neglect magnetic dipoles. And we can't even say why. I mean, it's two orders of magnitude. So this is not like we are making approximations that we like, or like the approximations that would make our life easier. All these approximations can be substantiated. And again, if they say, well, this is wrong approximation, for you it's a moment to know. Tell me why. Because, well, maybe it was a wrong approximation, but they will tell you what was wrong with this. You have to have arguments, then you have discussion. And then from this, once you have discussion, you're in the learning process. I don't trust anybody. Check. You have to be convinced yourself. Okay? Yeah? Other questions? So if not, thank you very much. Yes, I'm already...